Hi, I'm LadyJenevia. This video is a review of Bridgerton Season 2, and more specifically, I'm covering the characters and plots that are not Kate and Anthony, because I have already posted a video just talking about them as characters and their relationship. Some of the subplots I won't be able to say much about, even if I want to, because Netflix has provided a list of plot points or details that reviewers are not allowed to reveal before the premiere, but I will do my best to provide some sort of feedback, even if the details are lacking. Starting with the Bridgerton family, Daphne is more of a recurring character this season, and I actually really like what she brings to the season. She and her mother have some really important conversations with Anthony because he's not really pursuing or prioritizing love as much as he should. But because both Daphne and Mama Bridgerton know what it feels like to truly be in love, and because they love Anthony, they can recognize more of what's going on with him than others might in a world where marriage is more strongly rooted in being an economic transaction than a romantic one. While I can already guess that your favorite Anthony scenes will be the ones with Kate, I still believe you will enjoy his scenes with Daphne. I know I did. The Regency period is one where, like I've said many times before, marriage is largely driven by economic anxiety. The society is set up in such a way that it kind of forces people to get married regardless of whether or not they want to. This means that while marriage is extremely common, marrying for love is more of a rarity. As a result, not everyone is good at recognizing when there is a deeper romantic connection or romantic potential between two people. So this season, we love Daphne and we love Mama Bridgerton. Also, Daphne in season one, she was just giving me too much Sandy Olsen, that innocent, naive, ingenue vibes. I don't want that. But this season, you can tell she's lived a bit more life. She's married. She has a ridiculously cute baby. She knows things that her brother does not. She's the one with the wisdom to offer. Next up, the Bridgerton siblings. Unsurprisingly, I am not referring to the youngest Bridgerton siblings. They really don't have anything of note to discuss. Specifically, I will be talking about Benedict, Colin, and Eloise. All three of them have this overarching sense of self-exploration and self-discovery, that type of vibe in this season. However, the way that each of them goes about that varies. Benedict is still pursuing his interest in art, and Benedict's material is probably the most lighthearted out of these three. I don't know if I had much of an opinion going into watching season two on him as a character, but I think I've warmed to him now. I think season three is supposed to be the one where he will be in the top-billed romance, and I think I've said this in another review video, but I really want to reiterate that I really hope they keep this humorous dimension to him when he has a more prominent role and romance in the story. Eloise probably has the most interesting character arc and story out of these three. I think the writers have done a terrific job of using the foundation they laid in season one for her and really expanding on that and using her in a way that makes sense to the creative approach they're taking for this television series, where despite the Regency setting, they are adapting these stories and infusing a modern sensibility into them. Daphne in season one was a bit closer to the picture-perfect ideal of a Regency woman. She got to be crowned the diamond, all the men wanted her, but Eloise is her own person and she doesn't really fit into that mold of what the Ton considers to be an ideal woman. So she gets to really question the society that she lives in and the expectations which are placed upon women. And it's refreshing to have that type of material in the mix, so you can have a more varied, well-rounded viewing experience for the season. I'm actually very interested in seeing what the long-term plans are for Eloise after watching season two. I have a feeling that her character will be one that gets to move significantly away from the source material, despite the fact that I have not read any of the books besides book two. I did, however, read in an article online that her love interest in the books was Marina's husband in the show. If that information is not correct, feel free to let me know in the comments. I am not claiming to be an expert on the source material, and to be honest, I really enjoyed watching season two without knowing what was in the book beforehand, so I was able to be surprised. So I have a feeling that going into watching seasons 3 and 4, I may be taking a similar approach of just watching the show as unspoiled as I'm able to be. And then if curiosity strikes, and if I'm reviewing those seasons here on my channel, then I can read those corresponding books after watching the seasons and then seeing how they compare. Now for Colin, how do I put this nicely? Colin is kind of a mess. I think his central role in romance isn't supposed to happen until season 4. So from a writing, show running, and producing perspective, I would imagine that their aim is to start him off at a point that is much further behind where they want him to end up. He has a lot of growing that he needs to do. By the time the end of the season comes, there are some ways that you can see him maybe moving in the right direction, but also other ways where he's still just not at all there yet. I actually can show you some clips that I think convey how some of Colin's stans might be responding to him and his material this season. First, we have him at the beginning of the season.
Mine is an idiot. Oh. But he's my idiot.
And then the season carries on.
Oh! No! 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 No!
But deep down, I know you love who he is, so when all is said and done...
You're an idiot, but you're my idiot.
Mama Bridgerton. I've already hyped her up a fair bit because I love all the scenes that she has with Anthony, but as another note of feedback, she is devastating to watch in the flashback material. She acted her face off and broke my heart. Madame Delacroix is someone I cannot really say all that much about because of the list that reviewers and journalists were given about what we are not allowed to talk about before the premiere. But in a very broad, non-spoilery sense, I enjoyed watching her material. It gave her character more dimension and it made for an interesting part of the larger story of season 2. And she's another person I would be intrigued to see in future seasons and what it is that they might do with her character. She has her own dreams and aspirations to do more with her work. So if there's time to include it still in the seasons to come, I think I would enjoy seeing her do and achieve even more with her business. Lady Danbury is, as always, a legend. She's more or less the smartest person in the room at any given moment. I love all of her scenes with Kate and the wisdom that she is able to offer her. I also think that it was a genius choice of the show's costume designer to start dressing Lady Danbury in red, because that is a power move. She has a discerning eye, she's lived her life, she commands the space she's in. I just like everything about her. In season 1, Lady Danbury was shown to be this wonderful mentor and ally to Simon all the way from the time that he was a child. He didn't have anyone in his corner except for her. She helped him to become his best self. And the dynamic isn't exactly identical to how she is with the Sharmas, because she helped to raise Simon over a much longer period of time than the season 2 timeline of her sponsoring the Sharmas. But there are some similarities in a broad sense. When she makes a commitment to help someone, she will do a lot and do it well to get them the best possible result that she is able to facilitate. I'm going to be honest, I am not seeing nearly enough hype for Lady Danbury on the Bird app. It's understandable that everyone is excited for Anthony and Kate, and your excitement is absolutely warranted in that regard. But I'm just saying, don't sleep on Lady Danbury. Give her her flowers. Next, we can talk about Penelope. I'm not really sure how I feel about Penelope right now. I feel mixed towards her. I don't feel negative. It feels only natural to use Gossip Girl as a reference to discuss Penelope, since she was revealed at the end of season 1 as being Lady Whistledown. Gossip Girl as a show wrote themselves into a corner because originally in season 1, Eric was supposed to be revealed as Gossip Girl, but because fans were playing detective and were correctly guessing that it was him, they decided to scrap that storyline. That was a mistake. So when all was said and done, they just haphazardly decided to make Dan Humphrey Gossip Girl, which the more avid fans of the show have gone back and proven this did not work, because they rewatched episodes and cross-matched it with whatever Dan was doing or what was going on with his story at times when Gossip Girl would be doing something, and it just ended up making no sense. The writers of that show clearly seemed to be more determined to surprise the audience than do something that actually made sense. Really, Gossip Girl should have either been revealed to be Dorota, Blair's maid, That would have been a great let's stick it to the rich thing, but to be honest, the better option would have been to just not reveal, because Gossip Girl was a plot device. When you have to actually reconcile and justify the reasons for being a tabloid and expecting the audience to be sympathetic to a tabloid, it just doesn't work, at least for me. That brings us to Penelope. At first, I was really excited to see what they were going to do with her, because when the season starts off, it's exciting to get this glimpse into how this whole operation runs. How is she able to get this tabloid written, published, and distributed without anyone knowing? Then, as you've seen in the season 2 trailer, Penelope has the added challenge of trying to keep her tabloid hidden when the Queen is looking to track down the identity of Lady Whistledown. As far as drama goes, of course this storyline delivers. It's a very, very dramatic plot in this season. But when all is said and done with the storyline as it plays out across the season, I'm still left with a lot of questions. If you've ever studied, or if you've lived through the tabloid culture of the 2000s, you'll know how vicious and mean-spirited it was. But the thing is, that hasn't really gone away. It is inherent to the entire tabloid concept. What Penelope is doing isn't just petty gossip among her closest friends, in private. She is putting people's business out on blast and turning it into a spectacle, and turning that into a spectator sport. You cannot say that it's not mean-spirited. Tabloids are inherently mean-spirited. But on the other hand, I'm also someone who does not think that female characters should have to always do the right thing. I think they should be allowed to make mistakes and to do the wrong thing, and that can make for some really compelling dramatic material. And maybe they will grow out of it, and maybe they won't. Maybe by the time we get to season 4, and Penelope is presumably going to get her endgame love story, she will have grown and evolved for the better, so you can really root for her to get that love that she has been wanting since season 1. But with where she's at now, it's just challenging to root for her. I won't get into what stories she writes in season 2, but we don't need to use season 2 as a reference because we all saw season 1. What she did to Marina was so awful, and even if it worked out okay for Marina in the end, where she was still able to get married to someone who was decent and find out that the man she loved did in fact love her, Penelope had no way of knowing that any of that was going to work out for Marina's benefit in the end. Part of why you root for Kate and Anthony so much in this season to find love, besides their piping hot chemistry, is that they are so selflessly determined to do what's necessary for their families to be provided for and taken care of, and that selflessness makes them even more admirable, so you want them to find love for themselves. Penelope is sometimes ignored, or people can be a bit rude to her, but she also doesn't have a completely awful life. She has friends. The Bridgerton family is really nice to her, even if the people within her own family are not the most pleasant people to be around. There simply isn't enough in her life circumstances, in my opinion, for me to be as emotionally invested in her as I think the people making this show want me to be. I can't pretend I'm not judging her. I am. I don't like tabloids. And for the sake of disclosure to those of you who are watching my reviews, because I think context is important, I have previously been in spaces of entertainment media, entertainment reporting, where tabloid types and people who uphold that tabloid culture were extremely toxic and threatening to me. I was made to feel unsafe when people should have been conducting themselves in a far more professional manner than they were. So that is probably why it's inevitable that when watching this season, I am going to come into it with a bias against tabloid types, and that will color how I experience the material. And not all of you who watch the show will have that pre-existing bias from life circumstances that make you a little bit more resistant to that particular storyline. Maybe if they had framed what she was doing in a slightly altered way, maybe if they had explicitly stated that she was trying to save up money from doing this gossip tabloid to get away from her toxic family, I could reconcile it a little bit more. But until I can see what the writers are doing with her in these next two seasons, there will be this disconnect between me and that storyline. The writers might totally win me back over with her by the time we get into season 4 and she's getting her romance, but then it also begs the question of what other plans are in play for this show. Is season 4 supposed to be the final season? And if so, does that mean that she will stop writing this tabloid because she's a happier, more fulfilled person who doesn't need to tear people down to feel like her best self. If that were to be the direction that they would be taking that story, I would absolutely be intrigued to see how that plays out, because it's offering something really interesting thematically and being able to explore a person's insecurities and a person projecting harm outward onto others because of the harm they feel is being done to themselves. That makes for great, compelling dramatic fiction. But an important part of getting me to like that story in its entirety is you have to stick the landing. So I need to see what happens next with this storyline before I make my final decision about how I feel about it in its entirety. Let me know your thoughts and theories in the comments. And listen, I am not here to tell any of you that my opinion is the correct opinion. It's only my opinion. If Penelope is your girl and you have absolutely zero issue with what she did to Marina in season one, I'm not here to tell you that you're wrong. We're all going to experience the show's material in different ways, and at the end of the day, it's all fiction. We can all have a discussion here as long as no one is being vicious to anyone. I don't mind people having different favorites and different opinions about the characters on this show and their storylines, and potentially talking about that in my comment section. As for the whole Colin and Penelope thing, I don't think it's a spoiler to say that they're not there yet. I haven't read their book, but in a very broad sense, I am aware that Colin and Penelope are the main couple of book four. So the expectation that a lot of people have is that they will be the main couple for season four. Again, they might completely win me over once we get to their season, but they just haven't convinced me yet. And I am fully open to changing my mind. I do want to see what the writers will do with these next two seasons. And just to be clear, none of my mixed and complicated feelings about the character or the story extend in any way to the actress, Nicola Coughlan. She does a great job. She has more variety this season in what she gets to perform and emote. There's this one scene, I'm not going to say what it is or when it happens, but it's a big moment for Penelope as a character, and Nicola, she is terrific. She acted the hell out of that scene, and I think people are going to be shook when they see it, because you've never seen her like that. And also, her scenes with Colin, God, the secondhand embarrassment I get watching her pine after this boy, this man who is just giving her nothing, romantically speaking. If you want a better insight into me as a viewer and as a reviewer, if we're talking about straight heterosexual romances, I hate when a woman is anything even close to desperately wanting a man who is not reciprocating. Do you see this? You see this? This is House of Gucci, one of my all-time favorite films. When Patrizia goes to see Maurizio and she is begging him to take her back, it just twists my insides every time I watch it.
Maurizio, stop, please, 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 I'm begging you, please stop.
I hope you get it together.
Another example of that, I recently watched the screeners for the Apple TV series, and there is this one scene in episode 3 where Anne Hathaway throws an absolute fit begging a man not to leave her, and I couldn't stop myself. I yelled out loud at my screen, "Get off the floor!" In case you couldn't tell, she was on the floor when this was happening. Now, nothing Penelope does in season 2 is anything even close to being as extreme as those two examples I just gave, because these two are not even together yet, but she just keeps mooning over him and then doing nothing about it. If you know this man as well as you claim to, you should know that he's not very bright. Either get the up and do something, or find someone else who will actually show you some interest in a non-platonic way. I'm so tired. It also took far too long for me to actually feel like the friendship had any sort of reciprocity. Up until this point, I didn't even really know that they were supposed to end up together. I had watched these first two seasons more or less back to back. I hadn't read any books. I hadn't looked into any of the fandom spaces, and based on only seeing the seasons, these first two seasons, I didn't really know that it was supposed to work out for them in the end and that I was supposed to be rooting for them as a romantic couple. I didn't know until I started Googling things to do research for doing video review coverage of season 2 that that was the plan. And again, I'm not rooting against them. I'm just explaining to you that I didn't know for a while that they were supposed to be endgame. That message was not being as effectively conveyed to me as I would have liked. But again, I'm open to it. I think the writers have a plan, And I might love the journey by the time it's finished in its entirety. And to be fair, they have to play a much longer game for these two because they have to wait all the way until season 4 to be able to really ramp up their romantic connection. And all I'm saying is, I just wish that they would give him more to do in order to reciprocate the level of emotional labor that she has flowing out of her like a waterfall. She is constantly hyping him up. And you don't need to be romantically interested in her to hype her up right back. Colin might eventually blossom into a total gem, but they have not reached that point yet of fully endearing him to me as a character. As of right now, he's just too young, too green, and too immature. So once he's grown more and matured, presumably more of that will happen in season 3, I'm just guessing, that's when I think I will be able to start to really root for him as a character, root for them to end up together, and really get on board that train. In general, I just don't think either one of them is emotionally ready yet to fully give themselves to another person. I think both of them have to do a lot more growing individually. And then once we've seen that growth and maturity and maybe developed better communication skills, then maybe it will make more sense when they finally put them together. Now we get to the rest of the Featheringtons. And all I can say is,
let me pretend I care. Okay, I'm done.
They get a lot of screen time, and I cannot say that I'm happy about that. It was by far my least favorite subplot. When the season had finished, I could finally get a sense of what the writers were going for with this subplot, but I just didn't enjoy watching it. Now, to be fair, that could at least partially be because Kate and Anthony set the standard so high where you're so invested in what's going on with them and they have the most powerful hold on you as the viewer. And then they cut away to the Featherington family drama and it's just, ugh, again. I'm really not allowed to give details on this subplot because a lot of them are on the do not reveal list, but I just didn't like watching it. I didn't care about it. And I was irritated that all of this screen time was being given to them when there were so many other subplots going on with Kate and Anthony, with the Sharma family, with Penelope, with Eloise. The extra screen time, in my opinion, would have been better served for any and all of those other plots instead. There's this one part where Kate and Anthony are having a moment and we are all living for it. We're here for everything that's going on with them. And then what's going on with them has to change locations. And instead of staying with them as they move locations, it cuts away to the Featherington family subplot. And I got so annoyed and exasperated. I didn't order this. Please take it back to the kitchen. And then finally, after an unbearably long amount of time in that subplot, we get to return back to Kate and Anthony in the next location. And it is everything. It is so powerful. Now, I'm not saying any of this to be malicious, by the way. If some of you who are watching this review, you finally get to watch the season and you end up really enjoying this subplot, I'm genuinely happy for you. It would have been nice to watch the season and not be annoyed every time a prominent subplot was going on. But overall, I just really didn't enjoy watching this subplot. I'm not saying that it was poorly written or poorly acted. I've seen the season. I've seen the arc in its entirety. I can analyze the material and what they were going for with it, but I just didn't like watching it anywhere near as much as the other subplots in this season, especially when you are interrupting smoldering Kate and Anthony action for Featherington family drama. Thank you, but no thank you.
Getting tired now, though, to me. In the beginning, I was like, okay, it's cool, huh?
You just have to remember that looking at Kate and Anthony is like looking into the sun or a very bright light. So when you look at them, and then you have to look at something else, you can hardly see it. Maybe that's not the best analogy, or maybe it's the perfect analogy. I don't know. You won't know either until you see the season on March 25th. I didn't want to leave things on a negative note in this video, so let's talk about Edwina and Mama Sharma. I kind of wish we had gotten more of Mama Sharma, Mary, because everything I saw of her, I loved. She and Mama Bridgerton are the best mothers. They are so kind and warm and loving to their children. It is a joy to watch them. Anytime Mama Sharma is talking to Kate, I love it. I didn't count the number of scenes, but it felt like there were more scenes of Kate talking to Lady Danbury than her own mother. And I think that that may have been because Kate has taken on a lot of responsibility the same way Anthony did after what happened in his backstory that I'm not gonna say in detail on video. But if you've read the books... But whenever you do get these scenes between Kate and Mary Sharma, they're really sweet and heartwarming. There's also this one scene that Mary has where you really get to see more of who this character is and the strength that she has, but I cannot tell you any of the details, but you are going to live for it. Edwina is a character that when she was first introduced, I didn't know if I was going to be a fan of hers because I couldn't really get a read on her. When you first meet her at the beginning of the season, she's beautiful, she's polite, she's picture perfect, but I wanted to know, is that all she is? What does she have going on underneath that? And as the season progresses, she ends up having a really nice character arc. She's the younger sister and has to learn more about the world, about people, about relationships, and come into her own as a woman. I think almost all of my favorite Edwina scenes or moments are in the second half of the season. Without giving anything away, she has a really standout moment that involves a character you might not expect. What's really special about a moment like that is it's something that only the show can provide, because now that I have read the book after watching the season, the book puts so much focus on the main two characters and their romance that you don't get to explore the depths and layers of these other characters. And it's a really special moment for Edwina, and I think all of you are going to love it. No, I don't think, I know. I've talked a lot in my other videos about how much Kate loves Edwina and how she puts so much into trying to get Edwina the best, happiest life that she can possibly have. But what's really nice is that you will see over the course of the season that this love is reciprocated. Edwina adores Kate and wants her to have a happy life too. The Sharma family is so special, and I think when all of you get to watch the season, you're all going to wish that you were in this family because of how much love is in it. And at the end of the season, without spoiling anything, Edwina is actually set up nicely in a way that I hope means she will still get to stick around for season three. I will not get into any of the details, but in comparing book two to season two, I can see how one of the ways that the show is different is that the show expands the focus of the story beyond just one central romance. Other characters get to have their own seasonal arcs as well, and I want Edwina to get to be part of that mix next season, even if she's not the one in the main romance of book three. If you liked this video, don't forget to like this video. I will be making another Bridgerton season two video very soon, in which I will be answering fan questions about different Bridgerton promo images. So stay tuned for that and subscribe to my channel so you don't miss it. See you then. Bye.